got it in 2000. Oh! You got it in 2000. That's what's up, right? That's where we going. That's what we talking about, right? This ain't no game, man. We not playing with this thing.
Let's let y'all get on here and get it in, boy. Hey.
Oh, come on, man. All right, show. For sure.
Phone sometimes, bro.
That nigga don't
know
about some time. You don't need no phone.
Man, play again. Play again. I got to get it one more time. I got to warm up, man. Good grief.
This man want to hear this song, open the song.
Man, I see my queen on. Hey, baby. I see you, Tommy. Queen always at a rock.
Lord Jesus. God. You don't want to hear this thing all the way up again because you don't want to hear it.
I do. I want to hear that again, man. I see it so hot. Yeah, I can hear it here. I just want to make sure they can hear all this.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Good evening, this is Joaquin with the Daily Bread Radio Show. Coming to you live from the studio. Glad to be back with you all again. It's always an honor and a pleasure to be able to do what I do on a weekly basis. Thoroughly enjoy every week that I get to come before you all and share some information and just talk about personal finance, talk about God, talk about life, talk about things that's going on in the world. So today I got very, very exciting show. I was very excited. So what we're going to do is we're going to get into it. But before I get into our conversation tonight, we're going to start off with a little bit of more. I guess you would say not a little bit of more, but a little more intro music.
Yep.
We'll do that and give everybody an opportunity to join in and we'll get started. And then I'll go right into this week's conversation. So you all enjoy. Two agrees. Me and you in the studio. Got baby girl on. There's three. Women two.
Man, I
ain't
I'm wiser.
It's gonna be millions.
I'm sharing you now.
Millions, man. Millions. When I look back over all you brought me through.
I'm
Somebody just need to testify to somebody next to him. Tell him, I'm stronger. I'm wiser. I'm better. Much better. When I look back over what he brought me through, I realize I made it because I had you.
There you go. I always have to start off with that one. The plan was to play a different gospel songs each week, but that song right there for me, it just sets the tone for everything that I'm going to do. And I've been trying for 3 months, going on 4 months now, to change or come up with a different gospel song, but that one, that's been my mainstay from the first show, so I'm going to stay with that. Now I got my own personal jingle for the Daily Bread Radio Show, so it's just showing a lot of growth in the show. So tonight, what I want to do is share with you a couple of different topics and just give you, each time that I come each week, I will always want to give you some real life examples so that way you don't feel like what I'm talking about is really just theory, but what I'm trying to do is minister and pour into you about things that happened to me that I'm sure happened to you, but sometimes we just don't take the time to say or acknowledge the fact that this is confirmation that I'm doing what I'm supposed to do and I'm living the way that I'm supposed to be living, and God is blessing me with all these different things. So one of the things that I definitely want to talk about this evening was three things that we're going to talk about tonight. I'm going to make that four things. We're going to talk about goals again. We're going to keep in that vein because we started talking about it last week, and I went back and listened to part of last week's show, and it was in my spirit this week to bring that back again. Goals. We're going to talk about long and short-term goals and how to set effective goals. Then we're also going to talk about mindset. But keep in mind, we're talking about personal finance. But in talking about personal finance, we're going to make sure that we're talking about, you know, the way we think, how we think, the things that we're putting into our mind, be it records, books, information, things of that nature. And we want to make sure that we have our mind right. So we're going to talk about mindset this evening. The other thing that I definitely want to talk about is time, because I think with time, we don't spend enough time thinking about it, planning it, looking at how valuable time is as we're doing different things day to day, hour to hour, minute to minute, and how valuable time is. So we're going to talk about the importance of time and then organization. I started off this entire show about the importance of getting and staying organized. We all, and I have my books, because every week what I committed to is every week that I do this show, for as long as I do this show, I said that this is show number 10 of 1,000, so I only have 999 shows to go. So I'm doing pretty good. I'm pacing myself. I'm on a good pace. But one of the things that I said I was going to commit to is every show that I do, I'm going to highlight a book, because I think it's so important that we make sure that we are reading and we're researching and we're doing different things so that way we don't have to go to one source and think that we can find it. There's multiple sources, and many times a lot of the information that we're trying to get is in books. So each week I'm going to make sure that I hold fast to that, and that's one of my goals, is to make sure that I share with you a book of the week. So this week I have a special treat because I have two books of the week. So before we get into our topics this evening, first thing I want to talk about is these two books. So the first book that I'm going to introduce you to is called Double Vows. And Double Vows, this is Double Vows, The Key to Success in College and Life and Beyond. And this book was written by Kirsty and Christy Bronner, which are the daughters of our Bishop Dale C. Bronner over at Word of Faith Family Cathedral, Family Worship Cathedral. And the thing that makes this book special is these two young ladies made history when they went to Spelman College a few years ago, graduated in 4 years, and they were the first set of twins to graduate from a major college or university and to be double valedictorians. They were co-valedictorians coming out of Spelman. So why the reason that's important is this. Not only were they valedictorians, but both the twins were valedictorians. So they wrote a book, Double Vows. And the good thing about these young ladies, it goes into what we talk about each and every week on the show, is one of the big things for me is legacy and generational growth. So their father and their family are known in the hair care industry. Many people know about the Bronner Brother Hair Show and the Bronner Brother business. But within their family, they have a number of different ministers and bishops and family members that are in different capacities within the ministry. And these young ladies really were part of the epitome of the growth that came out of that. And they talk about being excellent and what happens when you're excellent at the college level. And one thing that I can tell you about college and how this book ties into personal finance is this. When you graduate double valedictorian, without even knowing them, the first thing that I know for a fact is they didn't have to pay for college. They went to Spelman. Now, just to keep it in line, to attend Spelman, and I'm sure Spelman is right in line with most of the other private historical black colleges from a cost standpoint. So you're talking about anywhere from $40,000 and $50,000 a year when you look at tuition, room, and board that they didn't have to pay for. So when you look at that, you're talking about $200,000 for one, but these were twins. So this is over $400,000 that they saved their parents in college costs that they would have had to pay just by being excellent and doing their work. So what I would like us to do is go out, if you know a young person that's, you know, 11th grade, 10th grade, 9th grade, rising 12th grader, this is the perfect time to buy a book like this, sow into them. Or you may have kids that are young, and sometimes they don't listen to what their parents are saying because now they think we're officially old. You know, we're 50 plus. So they think we old, so they may not be open to hearing it from you. So I would just buy this book and leave it laying around, or maybe give it to them and say, hey, it's summertime, maybe when you're out at the beach, take a look at this. Because you may be saving yourself $200,000 in your future. So it's definitely worth picking up. The book is only $14.95, and it's available on Amazon.com. So definitely go out. And then at the same time, you're supporting black business as well. So make sure you go out, pick up a book, a copy of the book, Double Vows, and make sure that you're pouring into some young people's lives. The second book that I'm going to talk about is one of my all-time favorites. This is a classic. So you definitely want to make sure that you have this one in your library. The cover is gone now, but I'll show you the spine. This is The Millionaire Next Door. The Millionaire Next Door. Now this book, this is one of those classic books that you definitely have to have in your home library. If you don't have a copy, make sure you go out and get a copy now, because one of the things that's important about this book is one of the authors of the book, and I believe it's Thomas Stanley, and forgive me if I'm not correct, but one of the authors of this book, and I believe it was Thomas Stanley, has passed away. So you're going to be limited in being able to get new content from these two authors, but this book is so powerful. And they didn't write this book from a personal finance standpoint, but the reason it's so powerful is that they're looking at the book from the standpoint of going out and doing research on millionaires and looking at all the different aspects of millionaires and how they think and what they really do as millionaires. Because sometimes in our mind, we have this image where we're thinking like, oh, if you're a millionaire, you're going to drive a Bentley, or you're driving a Rolls Royce, or things of that nature. And when you read this book, you really get to tap into the mindset of a millionaire and what many millionaires do, what they have, how they think. And the thing for me, when we talk about each week about confirmation and what we do, and let me stop right here. Before I go any further, because I have some people on Facebook Live that are asking about the call-in number. So the call-in number is 678-381-1973. So if you have a question, if you have a comment, or if you want to, you know, feed or have some conversation about something, by all means, definitely call in. The phone lines are open, and I'll break in my dialogue to answer any questions or any feedback or address any feedback that you have. But going back to The Millionaire Next Door, one of the things that is so powerful about this book, one of the sections is talking about the portrait of a millionaire, and that is very, very powerful. Things like, on average, our total annualized income is less than 7% of our wealth. In other words, we live on less than 7% of our wealth. So that's pretty powerful, because many times we hear about people that are living check to check, or they're utilizing everything that they have. Another thing that these millionaires were talking about is they have invested in appreciable assets. So they have money that's making money, and this is not just what we call 9-to-5 or linear income, but they have a lot of passive income generated from the businesses that they created, or they may be working a 9-to-5 and investing in other things. Another very powerful part of the book is they took this group of millionaires, and what they did was they asked them some specific questions about being a millionaire. Now, I want you to take into consideration these three questions. And it was funny, like, of all the questions that a researcher could ask a group of people, these were the first four questions that they asked a group of millionaires. So the first question, and this would resonate with me because these are some of the things that we talked about on previous shows. So the first question that they asked this group of millionaires is, this is the number one question: does your household operate on an annual budget? That's pretty deep, because the first show that I did talked about getting organized, and we talked about the calendar, and we talked about getting your bills in order, and how you can go out, list all your bills out, list your income, find out if you're in a profit, or if you're in a profitable situation, or if you're in a negative. That was like one of the first shows that we did. So to see this in this book, and I went back and grabbed it because this came to me this week, like, I need to bring on The Millionaire Next Door. But to see that in the book being the first question and the first topic that they wanted to talk about was very powerful. So this kind of gives me confirmation that everybody should be operating with an annual budget. Because an annual budget is going to, it's not so much as going to tell you where to spend your money and where not to spend your money, but it's going to keep you on track as far as how you're spending throughout the year. And you're not just making impulsive decisions about money that can impact you for the long term. The next question that they asked them was question number two. Do you know how much your family spends each, and the key here is each year. They didn't ask about this week or this month. It says, do you know how much your family spends each year for food, clothing, and shelter? Now, they talk about food, clothing, and shelter. Why? Because those are the primary needs of any person that's living in the U.S. or pretty much anywhere in the world. Because the first thing is, you got to have food first, because if you don't have food, then that's going to be your primary focus. And then your next, you know, goal is to, or need, is clothing, and then shelter. So you know you got to have these three things, but they took it a step further and say, well, how much are you spending, or do you know how much you spend on food, clothing, and shelter each year? And they gave some pretty powerful feedback as far as tying into the first question. And it some of the things that they said was almost two-thirds of the millionaires surveyed, 63% answered yes to this question. 63% of the millionaires that were surveyed knew exactly how much they spent on food, clothing, and shelter. So the question I would have is, do you know how much you spent, or you will spend, or you have spent on food, clothing, and shelter in the last year? The next question, do you have a clearly defined set? Now this is too powerful. Do you have a clearly defined set of daily, weekly, monthly, annual, and lifetime goals? This just sums it up. Everything that we're talking about on the show, all of this ties in together. It goes from your annual budget to knowing how much you're spending on food, clothing, and shelter. Those are the basic necessities of life. The third question is, do you have clearly defined set of daily, weekly, monthly, annual, and lifetime goals? And why is that important? That's important because if you don't have goals in place, then you could end up anywhere. You don't know what direction you're going in. You don't know if you're spending, saving, you know, spending too much, overspending too much. You don't know what goals you're working on. If you're losing weight, gaining weight, you don't know what direction you're going in. So establishing goals and having goals set really gives you order in your life. And the last question that they asked was, do you spend a lot of time planning your financial future? Now, those four questions are things that I wanted you all to just kind of, you know, resonate on as we continue with the show. But I think those four questions really set the tone for everything that we're doing on the Daily Bread as far as goals, everything we're talking about, budgets. We're really trying to get everybody to take those steps. Some of the feedback that I've been getting from the audience is, you know, people have started to take steps as far as getting their calendar set up, getting organized, and just cleaning up. And one of the things that I wanted to talk about tonight as well is the importance and the, I guess you would say, the necessity of just getting organized and cleaning up. Now, me and my wife, over the Memorial weekend, we decided that we were going to just start to clean and do some real nitty-gritty house cleaning. Because a lot of times we know when people come over, as you're working through life, you know, you're ripping and running and going day to day. So a lot of times when you have things in the house, you either are putting them off, addressing them. So you may have a stack of mail somewhere. You got some other stuff like tax liabilities. And, oh, I need to deal with that, but haven't really gotten around to it. Then you got another area over here where it's just like clothes and stuff you should have gone through. Maybe you've outgrown them. You meant to take them to the Goodwill, what have you. But you just never gotten around to doing it. So what we said was, over the Memorial weekend, we're going to just go on a cleaning spree where we go into that drawer, because everybody has that drawer where you're just throwing things in there, or that closet where you're just throwing things. It looks clean coming to the house. Oh, this is a nice house. It's nice and neat. You know, Joaquin and Ty, oh, you got a beautiful house. But when you start going through those closets and them drawers, that's where you find the bodies. Oh, it's like the mafia. That's where the body's at. So we, heaven forbid if you open one of these closets or one of these drawers, because you may be shocked in what you find in there. But what I find is that we're no different than the average household, because most households have that. So we start going through this whole cleaning spree, cleaning up everything. We're shredding. We're doing this. I'm talking about deep into the night on Friday night. And the thing that every time that I do this, I always, always get blessed. Now, we start cleaning up. We clean and clean and clean. I go through a drawer. Open the drawer. As soon as I open the drawer, the first thing I find is a letter. Here's a letter. So I brought the letter in today because I was like, they're not going to believe this. So I brought the letter, and me and my wife was laughing about it. But this was a letter from our mortgage company. And then I'll read the letter to you, and just to show you how funny it is. And then I'll tell you where I found it. It says, your loan company recently conducted a review of your mortgage account serviced by our loan servicer. And during the review, it was determined that some of the late fees were inadvertently assessed to your mortgage account. Enclosed, please find a check refunding that amount that was inadvertently addressed. Now, you're probably thinking like, oh man, yes, late fees and just life, wasn't that major, you know, we weren't at risk for anything. The funny thing about that is, today is June the 1st. We found this last Friday. Last Friday was May 26th of 2017. The date on this letter, when they sent the check, mm-hmm. August 30th, 2016. Mm-hmm. August, and no, not no little bit of money, a nice little bit of money mm-hmm. that we just, I was like, so the first thing I thought about was like, man, they ain't gonna bust this check. They gonna, you know, oh, 90 days, it's voided after 90 days and so on and so forth. Man, I put on my little suit, put on my best little tie, eased in there, and just slid it, made sure I went to the brother line, you know. But went in there, and they cashed it. But the thing, that the bigger rule or the biggest lesson in that is, had I not taken the time, my wife and I, had we not taken the time to just start to clean, we were around talking about we need this or we need that. God got provisions already for you in places. And when he said that, the message I took from it was like, if you clean up, you'll find a lot of stuff. Mm-hmm. That was just one instance. Now, that's just one. Now, this happened to me maybe, this happened to me maybe like 2 months ago. Me and my wife purchased a car. After we purchased the car, the dealership was supposed to send us a refund. So we went on vacation, came back, no refund, never seen it. We went back and forth to the dealership. Dealership said, hey, I sent the letter. We was like, no, you didn't. So we going back and forth with the dealership. Oh, this ain't good customer service, and you all should be doing this. So they had to go through this whole workaround, do a manual, cut us a check, send us an apology. We really appreciate your business, so on and so forth. Start cleaning up. What do I find? I sent the check. I find the check that they sent to us the day after we bought the car. I find this is the second one. Look, the check ain't even cashed. It's still in the envelope. The check is right in here. I couldn't cash it because I already cashed the other one that they did the workaround on. But what that showed me was that we have to take the time to get organized, clean up, and get really, really tight on what we do. Get tight with our budgets, start counting, understanding where we're spending our money, and start keeping track of it. I mean, people like Rockefeller, people used to laugh at them, but Rockefeller, what he did with his family, if you read some of his books, he talked about like all of his kids, they had to account for all of their allowances to the penny. If he gave them money, when he came back and said, hey, what did you do with that $5 that I gave you? Because remember, this is like 1900, early 1900s. But he wanted to know, his kids had to give accountability to him for every cent that they spent. Every cent. So now you think about this. If you went to your house right now and just got all of the change out the drawers, all of the change out the cabinets, all of the stuff you got laying around, I guarantee you, you got over $100 in change in your house right now. Over $100 guaranteed in your house right now. Right now. So what could you do with that? You could take that. It may not seem like a lot, but guess what? You got another bill that you're going to have to pay, say this month. Might be a water bill, gas bill. We joke on the show about paying your trash bill for the year. You could take that $100 and put it on a bill. But at least it's being applied to something and you're not just sitting on money. And then at the same time say, I don't have. You're squandering money. So we got to get really, really tight in that area. So that ties into our next topic, which is goal setting. And we're going to talk a little bit about short-term and long-term goals. Short-term goal, those are goals that you need to set that you want to achieve in the next 12 months. That's a short-term goal. So if you want to lose a certain amount of weight, if you want to have a certain amount of money, if you want to start a business, if you want to increase your business, if you want to, you know, start a radio show, if you want to grow your radio show, set a goal. But when you set that goal, just know that that's a short-term goal. But the thing about short-term goal is this. Excuse me. Once you have a goal put in place, at least you know what direction that you're going to be going in. Me, I always use myself as an example. We started this show in February. Here we are in June. I wouldn't have, if I hadn't set that goal and started working on it, there's no way I could have done these shows every Thursday from February to June. So just doing and staying in that path for that period of time, that's kudos. Kudos to us. Kudos to me. Kudos to my wife, people supporting me. Kudos to you, all of the people that are on Facebook Live, everybody that's on the radio show. Kudos to you because one of the questions I used to always get when I was in college, when I went away, because when I would leave Florida and go to D.C. and come back home, first question I would always get is, are you still in school? And what that meant was to me was I still working on my goal? And my goal was to graduate from college. So it's the same thing with us. You hear people starting and stopping things all the time, but set a goal. Say by the end of the year, you're going to do X. But go ahead and start something so that way you can follow it through and not be, you know, discouraged when things are not happening because you don't have a goal in place. That's short-term goals. Long-term goals. Let's talk about long-term goals. Long-term goals are things that we need to look at that are going to be achieved. It's going to take longer than a year. Some people set a 5-year mark, some 10-year, and some a lifetime. So when you start thinking about 5-year, 10-year, some of that is going to be things like retirement. Oh, I want to go on a dream vacation. I want to go to Aruba. I want to go to, you know, Bali or, you know, things of that nature, Bora Bora. That might be a 2 or 3 year goal. Or you may have a 2 or 3 year goal to say, hey, I'm going to be able to amass a certain amount of wealth in the next 36 months. Or I'm going to be able to eliminate a certain amount of debt in that period of time. So those are the type of things that you want to put into what I call your long-term goal bucket. The good thing about your long-term goal, make sure that your long-term goals feed off of your short-term goals. Because a lot of times when I'm meeting people, I ask them about their short-term goal, they give me one set of goals. Then when I ask them about their long-term goals, they got a different set. They need to be congruent. They need to go together, like interlocking, so that way one builds on the other one. Because the thing is, your long-term goals should be part of your short-term goals, and your short-term goals should be part of your daily goals. So if you're saying you're going to amass a certain amount of wealth, or you're going to have a certain amount of debt elimination over a certain period of time, then the thing you got to be thinking about is making decisions on a daily basis, because it's going to come back down to the type of habits that you develop and the things that you do on a daily basis. It's not going to be what you did monthly or what you did yearly, but day to day, you know, do you take your lunch versus buying lunch? May not seem like a big deal to you, but when you sit down and do the math, $10 a day, buying lunch, you go to work 5 days a week, that's $50 a week, that's $200 a month, that's $2,400 in a year, that's $24,000 in 10 years. So just making that one decision, do I buy my lunch, take my lunch? So you might be able to cut that in half, take your lunch, now you're spending $5 a day, or it might be your Starbucks coffee or anything else that you might buy on a daily basis. But it has to come back to making those daily choices. So I got to give a quick shout out. I see WAP. Appreciate you joining. Teresa Duval. Because you know I can't just say it like that. It got to be Duval. That's for all the homies out of Duval. Kitty Gray, lifelong friend. I see you on as well. DeRock, Tanya Alford Thompson. I see you on as well. She's always there. Has been there for me. 26 years and counting. Skilly, I see you. Anthony Jackson, that's his government name. He's also from where? Duval. So I have to always shout you all out because I appreciate the support. I couldn't do it without you. And I definitely appreciate you tuning in. So your long-term goals. Make sure your long-term goals coincide with your short-term goals. And the thing I've been talking about recently, too, is make your goals big. So now that we're on goals, let's talk about don't make no small type goals that you know you can hit that you've already done before. Make a what they call a big, hairy, audacious goal. Like say, make a goal like, you know what? I don't want to own no Subway. I don't want to own no franchise. I want to own 30 franchises in the Southeast. I want to own 30 Subway franchises in the Southeast, that are generating 15 to 20% positive net cash flow every month. Set a big goal, because if you set a big goal, that means that that's what you're going to need God for, number one. Because you don't need God for them little small goals like, hey, I'm going to start me a landscaping business, get me a lot. You can do that like instantly. You can just go down, get you a lawnmower, knock on a few doors, boom, you in business. But if you say, no, I want to have the largest landscaping and tree company in the Southeast. No, matter of fact, I want to have the largest landscaping and tree service in the nation. Those are the type of goals that's going to take effort, energy, a lot of your time, a lot of your development. Those are the things that you set your goals real high, because you only got a certain amount of time. So you don't need to be setting goals where you want to be average, mediocre, and things that you know you can already do. Stretch your mind. Do some stuff that you know or you may not know that you can do. Just stretch yourself. Don't stay on the bench at that 135. Just say your goal is like, hey, I'm trying to get up to 325. I mean, that's the type of goal that you want to set. Or 500. But stretch yourself. Think about all the stuff that you can do. Put that into your goals. And while we're still on the goal topic, the other thing that I want to share with you is this. When you set your goals, use what I call the SMART method. And SMART is an acronym for specific. Your goal should be specific. So don't say, hey, I want to earn more money, or I want to, you know, be rich. You have to be specific when you set your goals. So you have to set specific goals. I want to amass $1 million net over the next 36 months. That's specific. What goes in with specific is it has to be, your goals have to be measurable. So again, you can't just say, I want to be rich or I want to be healthier. No, you have to have something that's specific. And then whatever that specific goal is, you have to be able to go in and measure it. So that way you'll know, because measuring is like a compass. You'll know whether you headed towards the East Coast or you headed towards the West Coast. Because you wouldn't just get in a car and start driving. You need to have direction. So that's why you need to measure. You need to measure if you get closer or further away from the goal that you're setting. The A is for attainable. Now, attainable means that that could be as large as you want it to be. And attainable is, it's all up here. So one of the things with attainable, though, is this. Something that's not attainable for me, I can't say right now at 50, I want to go to the NBA. It ain't going to happen. Just know that is something I know that is not going to happen. So it's not attainable. So that's attainable, and I know that's not attainable. So when you set your goals, you have to make sure that they are something that you know with God's help and with your effort and energy and focus and drive and desire and hope and belief, that's something that you can do. But not some things are just out of scope, what I call out of scope. I'm not going to the NBA. I just got to realize that I'm 50, so I'm not going. The R is realistic. And this would kind of coincide with attainable. Realistic is, again, you want to have something that you're working towards that is realistic to you. Don't let somebody else squash your dream and say you're dreaming too big or you can't do that. Some things, going to the NBA, not attainable. But me developing and creating 30 franchises, 30 Subway franchises in the Southeast, that's realistic. Because if I get to work on it and get the funding and get my financing in place, those are the type of things that could be realistic for me. I can do that. We look at people like Elon Musk. Elon Musk, he's not even looking at no, okay, I've done the car, I've done the Tesla, I'm good with that. But he's trying to do commercial space flight to Mars. Listen to this, commercial. He's developing rocket ships right now where he's saying, hey, for a fee, you can get on this rocket ship and ride with us to Mars. That's way out there. Is it realistic? It's realistic to him, and that's his goal, and that's what he's working on. But to us, that just shows us, hey, you need to really, really, really set them goals very high. And the last one, the T in that SMART goal is, it stands for, you need to have a time element to it. So if you're going to set a goal, you can't just set a goal, I want to be rich. You have to set a time goal. I want to amass $1 million net over the next 36 months by April 22nd, 2020. You have to set a timetable. So the reason you set a timetable is just like everybody else. When you're building a building or you see all this development going on, these people not putting buildings in and businesses and saying, when is it going to be open? It'll be open soon. No, they're on a timetable. Opening in the spring of 2018, opening in the fall 2017, we're going to have this. You got to have a timetable on your goals. So that way, as you're going through time, because every time is going to pass anyway, as you're going through time, you need to be able to measure that goal. So that's something else. That's a SMART goal process. So as you're setting your short-term and long-term goals, make sure that you stay in that space. We've talked about time. The thing I'm going to tell you about time is this. Everybody, I'm 50, so everything that I'm doing now, I'm trying to work with a sense of urgency. I'm trying to duplicate myself, leverage myself, delegate as much as I can do so I can focus on the things that are important, because time is like money. You can't waste time, because when you're saying, well, hey, you know, I'm going to do this, or I'm going to just chill out, or I'm going to just kill time, you got to be thinking that's time that's taken away from your goals that you're saying that you want to achieve or the things that you're working on. You got to have balance. So I'm not talking about being imbalanced. I'm talking about doing too much, you know, recreational or chilling or things. That's cool. But when you're doing things like I'm going to the barbershop or I'm going to the salon, you need to take a book with you. Or you need to take your binder with you. Or you need to take your phone with you and be making all of those phone calls, those cold calls that you got to be making on a prospect that you're doing. Or if you're working on a design, you should not be sitting up in a salon for 2 hours idly watching the TV, just talking about, you know, whatever we're talking about in the barbershop or in the hair salon. Or if you're waiting on your car to be serviced, or if you're waiting on somebody to do something in the doctor's office, always have something with you that you can be working on every minute of the day, always. You should always be working on something. And the more that you do that and you work with a sense of urgency, the more you're going to see your goals come to manifestation, the more things you're going to be able to get done in a shorter period of time, and the faster you're going to be able to live some of those dreams that you've been dreaming about for many years and that you just haven't maybe put the time, effort, energy, and desire behind. And now you have those keys that you could do that. The last thing is organization. And we talked about organization. I can't say enough about that because in the upcoming weeks, one of the things that I'm going to be looking at doing is I'm going to go back and revisit it. I'm going to bring the calendar back out. Because with the calendar, a lot of people have been asking me about, like, tell me how to do that again. And so what I'm also doing is I'm developing some videos that's going to be on YouTube so that way I can just walk through that process. In addition to the YouTube videos, we're also in the planning for a website. So pretty soon you'll be able to go to the website, download the video, or download the instructions on how to effectively set up your calendar based on, I guess you would say, the tenets or the instructions from the Daily Bread Radio Show and me, Joaquin. So all of that's in the making. Another thing that we want to talk about today, I'm going to go ahead and let you all in on some powerful information. Definitely want to write this down and spread the word. You can send it out on Facebook and things of that nature. I have partnered with a nonprofit organization, and the nonprofit organization is called American Financial Literacy Association. Now, this nonprofit organization, the primary objective of this nonprofit organization, American Financial Literacy Association, is to provide scholarship money for graduating seniors, graduating college seniors that have exhausted all funds and are at risk of not graduating. That is that nonprofit's primary objective, is to take the funds that it raised and reach out to different colleges and universities and work with their leadership to say, hey, do you have some students that are at risk for not graduating because they've exhausted all of their funds and they just need that last little bit of money? This is a very real, I would call it an epidemic. It's a very real issue, especially in the historical black college community. I would say in the predominantly white community from a university standpoint as well, because one of the things that Howard sent out this year, they had been talking about it in their magazine, the Howard Alumni Magazine, but this year they started to send out emails each week. It was like 6 weeks leading up to graduation, and the emails would say something like, we have 600 students or 700 students that are at risk for graduating, and their combined aggregate outstanding balances is $1 million. And would you like to make a donation to help them or help them to be in position to graduate? Now, the reason that's very important is this. If you think about the number of people that don't graduate, now let's talk about money, personal finance, and being able to be in a position to make this type of donation. Making a donation to the American Financial Literacy Association will help someone in the future to graduate. So we're going to start off with small increments in our scholarships. We want to start off at 250, then we plan to grow to 500, and then 1,000, and then so on and so forth. But think about how many students, if they got to their last semester or the last year of college, whatever their degree is in, and for whatever reason they don't graduate. If they don't graduate and they've done all of that, that's a travesty for not just them, but for the community at large. And why? Because it's a ripple effect. I might have been a poli-sci major, was planning to go to law school, might have already got accepted. What if you already got accepted to law school? Or what if you've already got accepted to medical school, and then you got to your last semester of undergrad, and you didn't graduate? If you don't graduate, you're not going to law school. Not that next fall, you're not going to go. You may go in the future, but just think about, If you don't have any money in that last semester, you probably won't have it the following fall, and you probably don't have the means nor the focus or the desire to come back and do that all over again. So it's just a huge ripple effect where we need to insert ourselves there and say, hey, you know what? I got $100 on that, or I got $250 on that. So the American Financial Literacy, the Daily Bread Radio Show is partnered with the American Financial Literacy Association to raise funds to help these students to make sure that they graduate. I understand people gonna say, oh, you can't. I know you don't have to help everybody, but if you see one person that's gasping for air and you help them, then be encouraged that you help one person, and then it'll turn into two, and the three, and the so on and so forth. So I want you all to stay, you know, stay tuned on that. We are accepting donations on behalf of the American Financial Literacy Association. So if you want to reach out to me, my email address, you can reach me at dailybreadradioshow@yahoo.com. dailybreadradioshow@yahoo.com. The good thing about making a donation to a 501c3, a nonprofit organization, is complete tax write-off for you, because you're going to be making a donation to a nonprofit organization. And that brings me up to my last topic, because I see we have about 10 or 12 minutes left this week, is some of the dialogue I've been having with some of my friends, some of my colleagues and peer group, is now that we're at a stage in our life, most of my friends are anywhere from late 40s, early 50s, early 60s. So a lot of us in that range are starting to find that the money that we're making now, we don't have enough tax write-offs. And so now we're spending or paying a very large tax liability because we don't have enough write-offs. So with that being said, if you want a very creative way and a very creative tax strategy, is to make a donation to a nonprofit organization or a charitable organization. So now you got a twofold benefit. You could be helping a student to ensure that they graduate, and then at the same time, you could be helping yourself lowering your tax liability. So if that's something that you feel that either you or you know somebody that could benefit by using that strategy, definitely reach out to me, dailybreadradioshow@yahoo.com, dailybreadradioshow@yahoo.com. Again, the call-in number, we have about 10 minutes left in the show, 678-381-1973, 678-381-1973. So we're doing a lot of good things on the Daily Bread Radio Show. I want to let you know about that. Other thing that I want to let you all know about is write this date down, July 4th, 2017. July 4th, 2017. I've been talking about this since February, and the kickoff for our debt club is going to be July 4th, 2017. So that means that me and my team, we have a lot of work to get done, but we're going to start off, it might be one person, which would be me, because I'm going to make sure I'm in the club, because I need to eliminate some additional debt. So it'll be me. And if you want to join me and be a part of a debt club where we work as a collective, don't come with the ego. Don't come with the I can't believe. Don't. If that's the spirit that you're in, then I'm going to respectfully ask you to maybe wait to the next benefit that we have, because I want it to be a safe environment where people can come and share and talk freely without being judged or what's this or what's that, but come in and say, hey, you know what? I got this Visa bill. I keep paying it off. I keep running it up. I keep paying it off. Keep running it up. And we're going to treat it like Weight Watchers. You come in and you will be held accountable, because I think that's something that always forces us to do more, is when you have a friend or someone that you trust to say, hey, you know what? Raheem, you've been talking about paying that bill off for a while. Now you've paid it off. And now we're going to put the pressure on you to, hey, you know what? You need to take the car, put it to the shredder. I know you're going to come up with all them different excuses about how many cars you're going to rent and you're going on vacation and you need your Visa card. But we're going to have the proverbial shredder that's going to be part of the debt club. And we're going to crank that shredder up each week to make sure that people that want to eliminate debt, and when they come on, we're going to give them kudos for they eliminate debt. And before you start doing that, you're going to have a plan. So July 4th, you'll hear more about that. July 4th, Independence Day. I know a lot of us will be relaxing. So it won't be on the 4th, probably be the 3rd or the 5th, because I know the 4th, it'd be hard to pull people away from that barbecue. So I'm already competing with LeBron tonight. So I feel encouraged. I'm competing with LeBron during the finals. But we had a joke tonight. We're talking about, because you know this is a gospel-based show. So you know all of America, you know, all these ministers are doing that last prayer when they know the game was coming on tonight. They were hurrying up like, boom, 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 let me get out of here. But it is going to be in and around July 4th. All jokes aside, it's going to be in and around, because that's something that had been on my heart. And I want to be able to help some people, because it's nothing like being freed up from some debt, freed up to be able to do some other things with that money that we're making and be able to put ourselves in a position where we can be a blessing to someone else and get rid of some of that debt and start to do some investing and start to, you know, really enjoy the time that we have allotted here on this earth plane and not just use year in and year out just drudgery and, you know, pain and suffering and, you know, carrying a lot of debt is very serious because a lot of people, you could do the research, but a lot of people even have situations where they've been driven to take their own life, like suicide. So I do a lot of research in that space from a personal finance space. So hopefully, you know, not saying that we need to go to that extreme, but you never know what a person is dealing with. And a lot of times that debt can change everything. We talked about that in last week's show about how debt can really take you to some dark places. So we want to give you some light. We want to give you some laughter so that way you can look back on it and laugh about, you know, how they took my car. And I really like that Intrepid, but Repo Man got my Intrepid. So, but he did give me some other cars, so I'm not complaining about that. But we definitely going to start the debt club. And that's something that I think is going to be very powerful because the next thing that we'll do coming out of the debt club is looking at some ways that we can pool some resources and have an investment club. So maybe we go out as a collective and buy some real estate or buy some franchises or invest in a certain stock or what have you. So that way you can get empowered because when you have access to capital, a lot of people say, you know, money is the root of all evil and all these other different cliches. But the thing that I see in the world is this. People who have access to capital are able to make some decisions that people that don't have access to capital can't make. So if you don't have access to capital, it's not about rich and these different possessions. Some people say worldly possessions. But the thing that you have to be encouraged with in your mindset too is God didn't create us to just struggle the whole time that we're here. He did want you to enjoy. You want that convertible BMW or you want a Lexus or a Benz or this or that or a house or what pool. He said enjoy that, but we need to make sure that we're enjoying it the right way. We need to make sure that we have some goals in place, that we're organized, that we're counting pennies, that we get back to being accountable. And then that way when you go out, and this was a joke that a friend of me and a friend of mine was talking about this past weekend. It must be true because Geico has a commercial about it, about when you go out with a group of people, everybody's kind of waiting for that check to come. And then when the check comes, everybody's kind of looking like, oh my goodness. We was having fun, laughed, everybody was, you know, good time. And then when the check come, now everybody want to turn into an accountant and start talking about, well, I only had the crab salad. I ain't even having nothing. I just drank water. And what's the tip? But wouldn't it be good if you could just say, hey, you know what? Don't even worry about it. Raheem got it this time, and the next time I got it. And you start to create that type of environment where you can continue to have that lighthearted conversation and joke and laugh and have a good time. And then not only can you do it, but then it becomes generational and then it becomes an expectation. So you don't have those alligator arms when the check comes and you say, yeah, I'll do it, but you don't really want to reach out there and grab that $150 meal. So that's what we're working on. So we got about 2 minutes left in the show. If you want to call in, 678-381-1973, 678-381-1973. Next week, we are going to have a recorded show on because next week we're going to have Masego. It's going to be taking place out in Snellville. It's going to be at 706 Grayson Highway in Lawrenceville. I said Snellville, but it's going to be Lawrenceville, Georgia. So next week, and Masego is something where it's a networking event. It's a place where you could come. You could dialogue with all of the different air personalities. If you have something, an idea, or a concept or a business that you could come there. We promote your business. You could talk to different people, like-minded, talk about your entrepreneurs, anything that you want to do. So Masego is next week, and it's going to be taking place at 706 Grayson Highway. And do you believe your business is worth a small investment of $10? So the reason we say that, do you believe, we've talked about investing in yourself. So for $10, you could come into this event. You could have your business promoted. You could talk about what you're doing. We even open the microphone so you can get up and address the audience with your, you know, whatever you're doing or whatever your idea and things of that nature. And that's always a good thing. Want to end the show, we're going to talk about sponsorship. We've talked about our debt club. We're also going to be starting a membership soon. So more information to come on the membership. So I'll table that for right now. The sponsorship is going to be tied to your business. So if you have a business or something that you're working on and you want to get the word out, the thing I like about internet radio is it is powerful. It is powerful. It's uncensored. It's like the Wild Wild West. We don't have no FCC or things of that nature. So we need to leverage this technology and get the word out. So if you have a small business or something that you're working on, for $120, that will give you 6 months of sponsorship on the Daily Bread Radio Show. You'll be a Daily Bread sponsor. You'll be listed on the website as a Daily Bread sponsor. And then each week when I come on, I'll make sure that we carve out some time during my show for me to promote your show. So you may have a financial services, you may have a hair salon, you may have a graphic arts business. So anything that you want to be promoted on the Daily Bread Show, the sponsorship is $120. Also with that, if you want to make that donation, if you want to get real creative, make a $120 donation to the American Financial Literacy Association, you can write that $120 off, just like you can write it off for your business from a business sponsorship standpoint, and we'll put you into that sponsorship category as well. We're right at the top of the hour. I want to thank everyone that joined us on Facebook Live, WAP, my wife Tanya, Skilly, Kenny Gray, I see you, Karen, Adrian, Teresa, everybody that's not listening, everybody who's come on and jumped off. I appreciate the support. I love all of you all. I thank you. Like I said, this is show number 10 out of 1,000, so we still got a long way to go. So no matter if you're vacationing this summer, you're not going to be on next week or so on, when you come back, I'll be here. I promise you that. If Lord willing and keep me healthy, every Thursday from 8 p.m. to 9 p.m., the only thing that I ask is just share the information, because it's going to continue to grow. So with that being said, I love you all. Peace. You have a great week, and enjoy the game, because I know that's where you all are going next. Have a great one.
That's a producer right there.
Oh, man. No, that's a personality. So you puffing at that. Yeah, look, that's a producer. Man, I love this show, man. I love this show. I'm going to look back. I'll be on Sirius Radio. I'll be on Good Morning America. I'm going to look back. They're going to say, man, where you stop? I'm like, man, you can go back and pull the old show.
I got something.
Yeah, I love y'all. Peace.
Got something I'm working on right now.